This video is about how I think I've uncovered the first ever shape that was discovered not by humans, but by a computer. However, before we get to that feature presentation, I want to explain why I'm here in a film studio, because when I was researching my new book about geometry and trigonometry,
that book is Love Triangle, out in the USA this Tuesday, August 22nd. More details later.
I was reading a paper from 1962 about a shape, get to that in a moment, and it said they used a Burroughs 220 computer, a computer I'd never heard of. So I thought, you know what, I've got to find one of these. I've got to film with it. And normally when I have that kind of a mission to find a thing to film with it, we end up in places that are very difficult or unusual to film in. And I was very surprised, pleasantly, to find out that the only remaining bits of the Burroughs 220 computer system were in a film studio in Lyons, Nebraska, which is why I'm at the Cosmic Films Studio, who not only said I could film the computer, they said I could use all their sets. So I thought I'd do the entire video about the shape right here. No. Oh my goodness. Thank you for joining me here on our adventure to find the biggest shape in the... Oh, wait, hang on, sorry. Forgot to put it in park. The biggest shape in the universe. And if you're thinking that's going to be infinitely big, that's not really a shape now, is it? We want the biggest finite-sized shape. So imagine some incredibly big, like arbitrarily large, but finite distance. And imagine a sphere that size that fills the universe. You don't have to imagine it. I've got a model. There you are. That's the sphere, the size of the universe. Let's call it the unit sphere for simplicity's sake. What is the biggest shape we can fit in here? And we're going to have to limit the number of corners too, because if you had infinitely many vertices, it would approximate the sphere. So for some finite set number of vertices, can we find the biggest shape possible? It's not just as simple as putting, let's say, 4 points onto a sphere and spacing them out so they're all the maximum distance away from each other. That is a separate and also very difficult problem. Sometimes it does work. So for a tetrahedron, 4 equally spaced points will give you the polyhedron inside with the maximum possible volume, but it's not always the case. So let's say we add 5 points. We've got to work out, how do we arrange 5 points so we have the maximum volume, the biggest shape possible inside there, or 6 or 7, or indeed 8. And that's what we're hunting for in this episode. We want the biggest shape possible that has 8 vertices that all sit on a sphere. Let's do it. We'll start our search with some of the more obvious nearby shapes. So for example, a cube. A cube has 8 corners. We'll find one of them first. Aha! Here it is. We've found ourselves a cube, and I can put that in my travel sphere just to check. Yes, all 8 vertices do touch the sphere. But now we want to work out what is the volume of that cube. Well, it's roughly 1.5396, and that's relative to a unit sphere. So a radius of 1, that's what the volume of the cube would be. But could we do better? Absolutely. If you move the corners around, you can definitely get bigger volumes. So for example, look at this, under this leaf, that is 2 hexagonal based pyramids stuck end to end. And if I use the seam on my travel sphere as like an equator and put it in this way, it means we've got all 6 vertices equally spaced around the equator, and then 1 more at the south pole and 1 at the north pole. And the volume of the double pyramid, just by eye, I'd say it's roughly 1.732, which, if it sounds familiar, it's root 3. It has the volume of the square root of 3. It's just amazing. And actually, the cube has a volume of 8/9 of the square root of 3. So this is actually 1/8 better. This is an extra 12.5% more volume compared to the cube. But can we do even better? Well, yes. I mean, both these shapes were known about before the 1960s. And if we want to find an even bigger shape, we need some more advanced techniques, which I believe are just over here. Just kind of around this thing. Ah, and through there. That idea of moving the vertices around to see what happens to the volume is pretty much the technique we need. You start with a shape that's pretty good, or even just 8 random points on a sphere, work out the volume of the polyhedron inside them, and then see what happens if you move the corners around and you work out which corners in which direction give you the greatest increase in volume. And you keep repeating that over and over again until there are no further improvements and you've found a big shape. The issue is with the over and over again bit, it's very computational heavy and you've got to do calculation after calculation. It was not feasible to do that by hand. So then, in 1961, a master's student at Stanford University realized that they had a Burroughs 220 computer system. And this newfangled computer could do those over and over steps to find this shape. And Donald W. Grace did exactly that. They had to come in at night because the computer was so popular during the day, but at night they could run their code. And as I'll show you in a moment, they did succeed. But while they were searching for a shape, I'm searching for the computer that searched for the shape. And it seems all of these computers were thrown out in the 1960s and after then, and very few of them have survived. However, with a weird quirk of history, some of them lived on in the film and TV industries, which is why I'm here inside a 1960s sci-fi TV show, because I suspect I can... Wait a minute. This isn't a real rock. Here we are. This way. Oh my goodness. We found it. Well, some of it. This is the control system for the tape readers of the Burroughs 220. And then here it is, the main event. This is the console for the Burroughs 220 computer system, as far as we're aware, the only one left in the world. And it doesn't run because this is not the processor. This is just the console. It's the monitor. It's like a really important computer to mathematics, but all we have left is the monitor. So this can show you what the data is doing and not much else. But the only reason we have even this is because of a gentleman named Bill Hedges. And Bill Hedges is the owner operator of Cosmic Films Studios, and they're standing behind me, aren't they? So Bill, do you want to plug this in?
Okay.
So we can see it. Look at that, in all its glory. And so Bill, I'm curious to know, why have you got a Burroughs 220 console?
Well, when I was a kid in the 60s, I always liked sci-fi shows on TV, and you'd always see computers like this on a lot of the shows. And always liked, you know, collecting props from those shows whenever I could find them. And this happened to come up on eBay, and I thought it'd go for, you know, thousands of dollars. So I put just the minimum bid on it, and I ended up...
And you ended up owning a computer. Yeah. So it's my understanding that when all the universities and colleges and businesses were throwing out these systems, Hollywood and TV studios were buying them up. Why were they buying up old Burroughs computer systems?
Well, because they're obsolete, they were able to get them cheap, which is, you know what the, you know, prop department's like.
Still true today.
But, you know, the fact that they had so many lights on there, you know, they could make them flash and it made it look like the computer was actually doing something.
Whereas modern computers look pretty boring.
Yeah.
Sat there. These are doing something. And what have you done to make these lights turn on and off?
I just tacked on, you know, the wires to the back, and I use a motor-driven cam switch to go through different sequences. So the patterns always vary.
And that cam switch is what they used to use on TV shows.
Yeah, before they had electronic switching, they would just use motor-driven switches.
So what I love is this is computing history and it's film and TV history because you've wired it up the same way it would have been wired up in the 60s to become a film prop. And importantly, you can reverse all that, right? You can take all that.
So yeah, because I wanted to keep it you know, I didn't want to alter it permanently because it's such a historic computer that, you know, I want to be able to, you know, change it back to the way it was.
It's true, these are the only known extant pieces from a Burroughs 220. When I realized this was the first computer to ever discover a shape, I contacted all the computing museums I knew, the private retro computer collectors I knew. Nobody had any parts of it. And I realized it's because this machine sold fewer than 55 units. It was not successful. It was a vacuum tube machine in a transistor world. It was obsolete almost before it was released. And the machine that Don Grace was using in 1962, we know that Stanford University got rid of it in 1963, but we don't know where it went. We don't know where any of them went, other than one unit, which was in some college somewhere in Illinois. We don't know where. When the college got rid of it in 1970, a technician took it home, put it in their basement, and 50 years later, their children put it on eBay, and that is where Bill Hedges found it.
Having something that's so historic is just fun.
It's absolutely fantastic, and thank you so much for letting me come see the computer, visit your fantastic studios. And if you want to check out Bill on YouTube, you've got your Cosmic Cat series. New episodes come out occasionally.
Yeah.
You don't want to rush them.
Usually two or three a year.
Yeah. You don't want to race through them. They are big productions. I will link to them below. But now I'm going to have a closer look at how this machine was able to produce that shape. So there are two options for finding shapes. Before computers, you just had to like wander around, look at, oh, there's one. A cube. That might work. Oh no, look at this one. Two hexagonal pyramids stuck together. But then in the modern computer age, you don't have to just be mining for shapes out there at random. You run your computer, it ticks, it churns, it crunches, and then one day it just pops open and there it is. A whole new shape discovered by a computer. More on that shape after these important messages.
If you love shapes, then you're gonna love Love Triangle, the new book by Matt Parker, out in the USA this August 22nd. It's got geometry, it's got trigonometry, it's got more trigonometry. If you pre-order a copy now at any bookshop, online or physical, you can register your pre-order details with Penguin Random House using the link below and enter the sweepstakes to maybe win a VIP Q&A session with Matt Parker himself. It could be you talking to Matt, but it probably won't be because, you know, so many people are going to enter who aren't you. The odds are really slim, which is why you'll also definitely get a free bookmark. Remember that video with Matt and Steve on the Greenwich Prime Meridian? Good times. Well, if you pre-order the USA edition, Matt will go back to the real Zero and take a photo of him holding your name above the line. And he'll send that to you as a digital bookmark. Guaranteed. Sweepstakes open to U.S. residents 18 and older. No purchase necessary. More details in description. Yes, if you previously ordered on Matt's gear, Matt will still send you the bookmark.
And now, back to the shape. Here it is, the shape that Don Grace found using the Burroughs 220. You cannot get a bigger shape with eight vertices. And if I put it into another one of my orbs here, look at that. It touches it in exactly eight places, and that is the maximum volume, the global maximum volume you can get, which Don did not know at the time. And one of the issues is you can get trapped in local maxima, which I'm pretty sure did happen to Don. The idea of gradient descent, or in this case, gradient ascent, I guess, to find a maximum, is that you've got some variables. In this case, it's the point of these 8 points on the sphere. You can then take each one and adjust it slightly, which is like navigating through a surface of all the different possibilities. And what the computer can do is take each of these vertices and just jiggle it in every single direction and see in which direction the volume increases the most. And then by adjusting all of them in a direction where the volume goes up, you can gradually evolve your shape to be a maximum shape. But is it the maximum overall, or have you found a local maximum? This is the issue that Don was facing. And we can pretty much guarantee he knew the pitfalls, because when I asked my good friend Laura Talman to 3D print all these shapes for me, this is all her fantastic handwork, she contacted a phenomenal programmer, a friend of hers called Roger Antonsen, to see if they could program up a modern version of Don Grace's code. And Roger found some local maxima. These two shapes have a volume of 1.626288. They are both bigger than the back-to-back hexagonal pyramids, but they're not as big as the global maximum. The green ones are where they're exactly antipoles, and the red ones are where there's no pole exactly opposite them. And this one, this has a volume of 1.709837. It's so good. It's got 5 points around the equator and then one above and two below. Instead of having six around the middle and one above and one below, one of them has moved down here, and it is a local maximum. You cannot move any of these in a way that increases the volume, but yet it is not globally the best solution possible.
So even though Don didn't mention it in their paper, given we found them, I can guarantee they were running the Burroughs 220. They were there late at night, lights flashing, and it would spit out not the global maximum. And when they found this one, they weren't definitely sure it was the global maximum. They just couldn't find a bigger one for all the places they started. In 1970, it was proven that this definitely is the global maximum. Don was right. This is the biggest shape with eight corners. It has a volume of 1.8157. And if you're thinking, is that a catchy multiple of the square root of 3? It is not. It is 8 times the square root of 475 plus 29 times the square root of 145 divided by 250. Not catchy, but it is the biggest volume you're going to get. So there you are. That is the shape we were after this whole time. And actually, now that we've found the shape we were after, I can put it there. Oh, I can already feel the energy lining up. And aha! Yeah! Mission accomplished. Let's get out of here. Now that we've found this shape, the remaining question, or rather, our next adventure, is this the first shape that was ever found by a computer? I think it is. But just because I can't find a previous example, which is not really a proof. And there's no better way to find out you're wrong than to put something on the internet. So I thought I'll make this video, and if you can find an earlier example of a shape found by computer, please do let me know. The closest candidate I could come across was Alan Turing's last PhD student was plotting differential equations in 3D, which was generating shapes, but they weren't finding the shapes. I really want something where you're not just plotting a function to see what it looks like, you're trying to actually discover a new shape. We'll see what happens. So hopefully we'll be able to put this to bed once and for all. Until then, please do let me know if you find any previous examples of other shapes, and we can prove if this is the first ever shape discovered by a computer or not by all working together.